Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Healer's Way, Book 6, by Alexey Kovtunov and Oleg Sapphire, translated by Jennifer E. Sunseri, narrated by Jonathan Johns. Chapter 1. It was only after the strange mage left that Wilson could again breathe calmly. Finally, it was all over. Although what it was, he still wasn't sure. What had transpired in his little shop was also rather foggy. A strange little incident. No more. He recalled just then, when he'd closed his establishment in the capital some 12 years ago, sick of threats, extortion, bickering customers, and most of all, royal orders. That's what really drove him crazy. The king's servants would show up demanding artifacts. And not only did they want the best items, they also wanted royal discounts. In effect, he was forced to sell to the royals at cost, meaning he earned nothing. They would claim that the crown urgently needed this and that, and right away. Aha! But of course. Of course the royals had a reason for demanding 700 contraceptive artifacts. It was a matter of national importance. Wilson shuddered from a wave of indignation. He didn't think much of the king, nor of the royal family. He thought they were run-of-the-mill snickering jerks, bereft of honor or conscience. Once he realized that, should he remain in the capital, soon or later he'd start killing every other person who walked through his doors out of rage and frustration, he decided to move as far away as possible. And that's why he'd chosen this little city. It was on the far edge of the kingdom and was famous as a place where absolutely nothing happened. Nothing at all. There was no crime to speak of, no gangs, no bandits, nor wars. In fact, Wilson had pored over the national records on crime statistics, and that's how he knew this. There was a single baron in charge here, and the only guards were his, numbering 40 troops. They had long ago forgotten how to wield their swords. Moreover, the women here didn't let their husbands sign up for the guards. They didn't want them to drink themselves into a stupor every night out of boredom. Standing around watching nothing happen was a tough gig. But to Wilson, this was exactly what he wanted. All he wanted was to live in peace so that he could carry on inventing new artifacts. He didn't want to have to create artifacts on demand and ASAP. Really, he didn't want to fill orders. All he wanted was to follow his inclinations. And, in this city, all he needed to live well was to spend 10 minutes a day fashioning simple artifacts for plowmen, and the rest of the time was his. Work, say, an hour a week, and do whatever his heart desired the rest of the time. He never imagined that he'd be robbed by some crazy mage. But then that's exactly what happened. For the first time in 12 years. It had to be his shop that caught the mad mage's eye. Now all he could do was wonder where he'd come from. He was a healer with formidable powers. Really, Wilson was ready to take all of his savings out of the bank if that would be enough to get this mage to leave him alone. But Wilson was curious. He knew something about interfaces, but had never been interested in bloodshed and stupid wars. He thought of himself as a creator, an innovator, lover of experiments, who thrived on the process of creating artifacts. He'd even built a laboratory under his house. It had fortified soundproof walls so that no one in the city had a clue about his experiments. Indeed, explosions commonly occurred down there as part of the process. But this mage, he was a mystery. Wilson had no idea why he'd been spared. Did the strange mage really want to buy those artifacts for his healing practice? It appeared so. Sadly, he apparently intended to come back and pay Wilson for them. Wilson would rather just let him have it all for free if he'd only stay away. But he had only himself to blame. He'd been the one to give the healer that rainbow stone. He just wanted the mage to go away. Not that these stones were rare. In fact, whenever a portal appeared, veins in the ground beneath them produced these stones, which were easily mined. And, of course, any respecting king took advantage of this, extracting stones for personal use. Wilson wandered through his empty store, sent a few customers away, and locked the door after hanging the closed sign up. Anyway, it could be worse. At least he was still alive, and that was what mattered most. And that meant he could get ready for the next meeting with the healer. He wasn't, after all, an archmagister, was he? Archmagisters were rare indeed. There were none more than three throughout the world. Was this mage from another world altogether outside of the interface world? Ha! Wilson had to smile at that. And he set about writing a letter to his sister and asking her and her son to come see him for a couple of days, just to be with him. With her here, the healer didn't have a prayer. As soon as I found out that the Negrievs were at it again, I realized that this was my big opportunity. I'd been waiting for it for some time now. I remembered thinking their infighting would last no more than a couple of days. But no, not that I was complaining, because it gave me a lot of time to get things done. This time my preparations didn't take long, because I'd had Chernomo prepare a strike force in advance. Too bad, though, that we only had one of the combat suits up and running, and not the most powerful one. Our leopard suit would be used by our most skilled operator, who wasn't yet ready for action. He was busy eating enough for three men as he grew new legs. I'd worked on him enough to get the process launched, and now he was using all of his resources to fully heal. In another couple of days, he should be able to walk. We just had to wait. Altogether, our force consisted of 30 guardsmen, all well-armed. Each of them had a protective artifact, and some had healing and slash or attack artifacts. But these were to be used only if we lacked the firepower from small arms and armored vehicles. We decided to strike while the iron was hot. Nobody would be expecting us, and we had to seize the opportunity. Should we fail, we might not get a second chance. It would take too long to accumulate strength. Far better for us to swoop in and do this thing, and then move on to the next order of business. It all went well, until the detachment was marching on the main estate. This was our end goal, and we'd engaged in skirmishes on the way. For example, that small detachment of the Viscount's guards stationed on the borderlands. Only they'd been expecting attacks from our side of the border. Because of Kuki's reconnaissance, we were able to surprise them. We rolled up to them from behind, firing off our heavy machine guns. They had no time to take cover even. It wasn't in vain that I'd worked on training my feathered scout. He was now so adept at electronics that he'd been able to ensure the enemy had no means of communicating at all. And forget about video surveillance. The pigeon destroyed it all, and thus we were able to advance on them totally undetected. Kuki flew on ahead, shorting the wiring on the towers and sabotaging antennas. He'd long ago honed his methods, and they were failsafe. Basically, we made our way through various small outposts. There was no way to avoid them because we were taking the shortest and fastest route. Sure, we could have circled around through forests and fields, but why? Our goal was to fight, and so why skirt the enemy forces? Once, though, we came up against an outpost with 30 guardsmen. It was heavily fortified with well-armed fighters. Only they, too, weren't expecting us. We didn't have time to go around them to attack from the rear. So we had the combat suit fly right into their combat headquarters through a wooden roof. I gazed upon the scene from afar, enjoying the sounds of the fleeing battle. First there was an explosion, then several flashes from energy weapons, and then the enemy detachment fled in all directions. But we were waiting for them with our machine guns. This might seem rather harsh, but I'd heard plenty about how the Viscount and his guards treated the peasants, and so I saw nothing wrong with summarily executing his guardsmen. Not that I sought to paint everybody with the same brush, but then again, if you had problems with the cruel treatment meted out to innocent people, all you had to do was leave. There were always alternatives, right? That meant that if they'd elected to stay in the Viscount's guard, They were fine with it all. It went well, our attack, except that this time Cookie hadn't managed to disable all means of communication. One of the officers managed to call someone and report our approach. More precisely, he didn't report it, but it was difficult not to hear the explosions and the howl of the suit servos through the phone thrown on the floor. And so I had to personally step in to deal with the last of the outposts. A dozen soldiers were hiding in a fortified stone building, clutching their machine guns, ready to repel the attack by the unknown enemy. And here I was, all alone, right on the roof. The suit carried me there, and I sent them off so as to avoid the risk of damaging our costly gear, that being the suit itself. And then I set about generating several bloody runes, spending half a liter of blood on this. And then, having crashed through the roof, I dropped down inside. Naturally, a firefight broke out, creating bright red flashes in the cramped room. My bloody fog thickened and swirled into clouds of small crystals that tormented the enemy force as it coursed through their midst. Meanwhile, I walked around with my sword, killing one after the other with well-aimed thrusts of the blade. In less than a minute, it was all over. Then I turned my attention to breaking into a locked room where the remnants of the forces had gathered. They could do nothing about the fog that seeped under the door. The men inside couldn't help but inhale the red haze, which turned into small prickly crystals. None of the men even knew what happened. We then made our way to the mansion, which was not at all prepared to repel our attack. Of course, it wasn't totally defenseless. This may not be a castle surrounded by high walls, but it was an aristocrat's home base, and every aristocrat around was well attuned to defense needs. And thus the Viscount had installed plenty of concrete pillboxes around his mansion. These were dug-in guard posts that were virtually impossible to penetrate, save for dashing up to them to toss grenades through the little windows. And all of the pillboxes were linked by a network of trenches. They'd been dug relatively recently, about when the Viscount and Viscountess commenced warring with each other. But overall, there were far less defenders here than I expected. I was surprised that Negriev sent his mansion's guards into battle. It looked like things weren't going so well for him anymore. Not that this would be a cakewalk for us, because 30 of my fighters against 100 or so of them, well, clearly the numbers were on their side. But what I had was the element of surprise, coupled with speed and my supreme arrogance. My armored vehicles burst out of the forest and immediately opened fire. My soldiers took cover behind them and began lobbing grenades at the enemy. Though we took them by surprise, it didn't take long for them to return fire. Apparently these guys guarding the mansion weren't as lax as the ones languishing on the outposts. Some of the mansion guards even had some simple artifacts at their disposal. What ensued was a fierce battle that I didn't even consider taking part in. I'd had the foresight to give my men the healing artifacts I'd scored. They were enough to at least keep them alive until I was able to see them, even if their wounds would in time be fatal. Remarkably, we weren't even out of the woods yet. There were swamps over there, and that meant they had nothing more than a purely symbolic guard stationed. Just in case, that sort of thing. And that is why it wasn't as bad as it could be in terms of the enemy pushback. But it wouldn't be long before reinforcements arrived. My target wasn't the guards, though. What this enemy needed was beheading, and only then would I turn to the unruly masses. And so I again relied on home delivery. Literally, I had the suit again transport me onto the roof. From there, I jumped onto the nearest balcony, and that's when the fun began. Valeri in the suit flew off to pick up another passenger, and I burst inside and faced off against the two occupants in the room. They'd been monitoring what was going on outside, through the windows. As these windows faced the fields, the entire countryside was spread out before them. Perfect for this duo, who were apparently a couple of snipers with powerful rifles. It wouldn't be easy for them to quickly aim their guns my way, and I took full advantage of this. Upon my landing, right away I fired two crossbow bolts at them and swiftly moved on. I went through every room on the second floor. Mostly there were snipers, and two of them managed to wound one of my guards. I understood this from hearing them talk about it. and seeing their satisfied faces, but they didn't rejoice for long. For attacking my guards, they warranted a special death that wasn't the swiftest. Let everyone know, for future reference, what followed such perfidy. Then Valeri dropped Chinomo off. My steely-haired commander of the guards rushed in with his sword at the ready, looking for the enemy. Fury flashed in his eyes, and he was clearly raring to dive into battle as quickly as possible. Only... "It's over," I smiled, shrugging.
"Meaning?"
He couldn't believe it when I told him that in one short minute I'd cleared the entire second floor. Totally. But we had to herd all of the servants into one of the rooms. Actually, I was doing just that as Chernomo burst in. I was telling them why they shouldn't go out into the hallway. And upon seeing Chernomo with his massive sword, they finally quit arguing about it. We're waiting for the mages and then we're heading downstairs. There's still more fun to come, I said, and in fact Negriev's main forces here were waiting for us on the ground floor. The command post was situated in a small yet heavily fortified room, and there were several strong fighters in the Viscount's offices who knew we were here. In the confusion of the battle, my pigeon didn't manage to eliminate all the cameras. Not that it mattered. I didn't expect to maintain total stealth all the time on this outing. The battle beyond the walls of the mansion was only gaining momentum. According to intelligence reports, my fighters were able to crush the first line, but they wouldn't be able to break through the second one. Not that this was their aim. Their function was just to distract the main forces, and nothing more.
"Commander, I've been told that the mansion has been breached,"
yelled the guard monitoring the security screens.
"Lock this place down,"
barked Belozerov, and a massive door began to slide out of the wall with a loud hiss. This kind of door couldn't even be blown up, because security was its primary function. Negriev was always extremely worried about being attacked, and so he'd had a veritable fortress constructed inside the mansion.
"Damn, who the hell is attacking us? Reports are that someone saw Bulatov, but we haven't been able to verify this,"
said one of the security guards monitoring the screens. But just then, they spotted the young head of the family on one of them. It was just for a second, though, because then a sassy-looking pigeon's face obscured the lens, followed by the bird's butt, and then the camera went dead. Anyway, Belozerov knew already that a large enemy detachment was heading their way from the direction of the swamps. Too bad for them, though. They were doomed. The Viscount's commander had managed to call for backup right before all of the communications went out, but they could have used a bit more time. As it was, the enemy forces managed to penetrate inside the mansion.
Boom!
Something massive just hit the door, and everyone fell silent. With most of the cameras out, all they could do was wonder what kind of idiot was trying to get into this room. Crazy bastards. It was futile.
"Don't let that distract you. Get to work,"
thundered Belozerov. And they all turned back to the screens. The radio still worked in the immediate area of the mansion, so they could still coordinate the defense. And not all of the cameras had been destroyed by that dastardly pigeon, so they could see up to a point, too. There were a series of blows sounding at the door, and then they broke off. Then a roar filled the room, but this time from elsewhere. The wall opposite the door started trembling and was then covered in cracks. Dust filled the room, but once it settled a little, the men inside saw a large hole in the wall. This, despite it being comprised of concrete some 1.5 meters in thickness.
"I told you it would be easier through a wall," said a smug voice.
"It's so crude, though, entering through a wall," said another voice, sounding indignant.
"Okay, but at least I adorned your little tunnel with patterns."
"Are these off-worlders?"
wondered Belozerov as he listened to the strange dialogue on the other side of the gap.
"Get them, men! We're being attacked by off-worlders!"
For a couple of seconds there was silence, followed by the roar of gunfire. Belozerov and his men decided to take out the earthbenders with a hail of bullets, but they were too rash. For over the gap, appeared a red shield shimmering with green veins, and every bullet that hit the shield ricocheted off it with a ringing sound and flew back at them like deadly little boomerangs. A complex rune, but an interesting one. I've always enjoyed combining various types of magic, and this time it turned out so well. I had to spend 400 milliliters of blood, but immediately restored the deficiency, and while the earthbenders worked on the wall, I added dabs of vital energy to the red clot. Not that I planned on healing anybody with this blood. I just wanted to add elasticity, connect the cells together, and then use the blood magic to give it shape. And it worked. But I did it all before the earthbenders were done. They were constantly bickering. One wanted to break down the door, the other insisted on going through the walls, so I could only wait and focus solely on protecting them from random enemies. Yes, that's all that was left now. Strays. Once we descended to the first floor, I walked around killing the worst of the lot with blood magic. I left the rest, who numbered around 30, to Chinomo. He was rushing all over the mansion with his giant sword, lustily slaying all who fell his way. In theory, our wraiths were supposed to be doing this. That was in our original plan. But we didn't take into account that wolves are intelligent, and they might even experience fear, which no one expected. It turned out that they were afraid of heights. Or maybe it was the combat suit. It was one or the other. In any event, when Valeri tried to carry them up into the air, they struggled, thrashing about like crazy. And they were mighty powerful beasts. Valeri couldn't hang on to them, and ended up dropping them right onto a group of enemy soldiers. Perhaps in the end this was even better. According to Kuki, upon landing, the wolves began tearing about out there, sowing terror amongst the enemy forces, still trying to defend the mansion. And this was just the beginning. As soon as they created the gap in the wall of the command center, the two Earth Mages fell silent. They generated a rather thick cloud of dust, but oh well. I then covered the gap with the blood shield, and then I stood back to gaze at it for a bit. The enemies were confused, but I too was surprised. The passage through the massive wall was both elegant and severe at the same time. One could see in it the signature of the two earthbenders, who were diametrically opposed in their approaches. But as soon as we took a step forward, the shooting began. The idiots holed up inside started firing from all guns. Good thing I'd invented that new spell. As soon as the bullets hit the shield, they bounced off it. Of course, the barrier was gradually depleted, but by the time it dissipated for good, the men inside were dead. Actually, two had survived, the commander of the guard, along with the second in command. They survived the ricocheting bullets because their personal shields were strong. I could feel their fifth rank from where I stood, and on top of that, they were physiques. Amongst commoners, this was the most widespread gift, and I would say not without reason. But these types were too bullish for my taste. They didn't care who they fought. Pugnacity works equally well on all elements, with the exception of vital energy, which is a little different from all of the other elements. Physiques were also good with melee weapons. However, so was I. Deftly dodging a swipe of the second-in-command's blade, I immediately lunged at him with my weapon, which was charged with healing power. However, he sprang back out of the way, and my blade whistled as it cut through the air. Just then, the commander himself entered the fray. He lunged at me, attempting to pierce my chest, and he succeeded. The tip of his sword passed between my lungs, exiting out of my back. But the man's satisfied grin quickly gave way to bewilderment. "Hey-ho," I shrugged at the silent question on the man's face. He couldn't get why I wasn't concerned about the mortal wound he'd inflicted, nor did he bother to activate his personal shield, as if he wanted to allow me to have a go at him. His sword was now stuck in my body, and when he tried to withdraw it, I slashed his arm. Then I slashed his legs, thereby paralyzing him. Easy peasy, now finishing him off. That is, if there'd been just the two of us here. But his underling hadn't gone anywhere, and he rushed to his commander's defense. Only he was blown away by a massive boulder that flew out of the passage and crashed into his chest. Yes, there were ways to wage a fight using boundless pugnacity, transcendental strength, a sharp mind, and a good memory. But none of these tools matter when a 100-kilogram boulder slams into you.
No, no, no. Not beautiful.
I heard Ludwig's indignant cry.
You should have released a cyclone.
Young people.
You want a cyclone, you do it yourself,
muttered Giovanni. I totally understood him. I took a quick look around to make sure everyone here was dead, putting an end to the suffering of the few who were hanging on, and that was that then. Actually, I'd expected it to go a little differently and had stocked up on a whole bunch of bloody runes in advance. But no big deal. I could still use them. Those bloody spears were useful in the security room. Several strong fighters were able to wall up the doors from the inside and fired at us through the windows. And I used the same windows for my spears, firing one after the other through them. We didn't linger in the command center and moved on. No time to hang around, judging from Kuki's intelligence. We still had a lot to do. A detachment of hundreds was heading here from the east, and there was also trouble stirring in the west. The forces battling the Viscountess's guardsmen were now retreating to defend the mansion. After all, this was the flagship residence of Viscount Negriev. It was like his little capital of sorts, and its loss would amount to a formal defeat. Having lost their command, the enemy outside began to gradually lose ground. That being said, I had to admit, these guys were solid adversaries. If not the best, they were at least well-trained and well-armed. And they weren't about to give up without a fight. So I sometimes received unpleasant news about losses among the ranks of my fighters. It wasn't for nothing that I'd given them plenty of artifacts. The protective artifacts were destroyed in a matter of minutes, and they also made full use of the healing artifacts. One of my men lost his protective artifact and his personal shield by a shell that also tore his arm off, the entire limb at the shoulder joint, so forget about a tourniquet. A guardsman with him immediately activated the artifact I had given him. It looked like a glass capsule filled with liquid, and if crushed, a few drops of concentrated healing energy will spill out of it. This is ideal for such cases. Clot the blood, compress the torn vessels, and live to see full treatment. Another of our guardsmen was hit in the skull. Here too our defensive artifacts ensured that although his skull was cracked, his brain suffered no damage. The rest escaped with bullet and shrapnel wounds, and were already on their way back to the castle. By now, Roman had more than enough experience to treat them, and the losses notwithstanding, my guard had made significant advances. They'd made it almost all the way to the mansion, where the very last, most heavily fortified line of defense remained. And that was great. But I could already see the enemy's reinforcements on the horizon. Headlights were visible beyond the forest, and they were speeding our way. We'd almost done it. This was our best bet, as the enemy was seriously weakened. Until now, we couldn't have dreamed of making it this far, not with over 200 guards here, along with the scores of guard detachments circling around. Now, yet again, there'd be detachments crawling all over the place, and I could see one from the window. Still, this was a far cry from what was here just a week or so ago. That being said, thinking about what could have been wasn't going to help now. We needed to do something, and fast. Right away, Chernomor gave the order to intensify the onslaught. I had the wolves assist our top detachment, and then led my earth mages to the balcony of the mansion.
What, right now?
Asked Giovanni, and I nodded, and then gave each of them a handful of energy crystals. We'd discussed this plan in advance, but I hadn't expected to have to implement it so swiftly. Still, what did it matter? I'd brought along some extra crystals, and that should be enough. What a shame, though, that we couldn't see the enemy's faces from here. I'd love to see their eyebrows shoot up when they saw it. I mean, when the earth opens up right in front of you, rises upward to form a solid rock wall, that was a sight to see. And it was a wall that extended over quite the distance. The mages gave it their all. They combined their forces, and I was there to help the energy in their bodies circulate far more efficiently. I focused on their channels, making them wider,
and also eliminated any wear and tear on their bodies from the stresses placed on them. This is pretty much what I did last time when Ludwig brought down that mountain, but then I'd used blood power, which functioned a little differently. In any case, in just half a minute, the mansion was surrounded by a 10-meter wall. This wall had no gates in it, nor any other vulnerabilities. It was simply a solid, smooth surface of stone and compressed soil. By the time the Earth Mages were done, we still had several full crystals of energy left.
Ludwig, just tell me, please, why did you create that massive statue of a pigeon on that tower?
Asked Giovanni of his colleague, but Ludwig made as if he didn't hear him. He simply cast a sideways glance at the roof of the mansion, where the feathered scout was staring at him. Kuki then nodded at him, and Ludwig sighed in relief.
Oh, that, it's to intimidate the enemy, Ludwig said, wiping sweat from his forehead.
I got the feeling, though, that he wasn't sweating from fatigue. Our wall with towers was around 50 meters from the mansion. The battle did not end there, because there were still many fighters on the territory. I ordered Chernomor to speed things up as much as possible, and once it was clear, to move onto the walls. After all, there were at least 100 people standing outside, and at least the same number would arrive any minute. I also helped with the cleanup. I did this by standing on the balcony and creating complex runes to detect where the enemy was taking cover, and then I tied those runes to attack spells. For me, this was a simple matter. I knew all of my own men, as I'd treated them all, and so I knew the cast of their blood. So the blood spears I created would only hit enemy fighters. All I had to do was fire them off, and they'd find the target on their own. I spent a lot of blood on this, but time was of the essence. What I was doing would help speed things up some. The rune evaporated in a bright red flash, and a long and very sharp crystal flashed in front of me. It then sped off, and sensing one of the enemy, immediately flew at him. But all of a sudden, it soared upward.
Kuki!
I wanted to curse at him, but there was no time for that. I stopped the projectile just in time.
Go now and get your flock out of here.
Right, I hadn't yet treated his friends, so didn't know their blood cast. Save for a couple of them. But Kuki made new friends all the time, and I didn't know all of them. And that spear I'd just sent off recognized that one of the pigeons was a stranger, and was just about to take him out. Oh, if only that pigeon had a digestive system like Kuki's. I could count on him to carpet-bomb the enemy. Massive, thick, dense, gooey matter falling down upon them. My spears, though, weren't as deadly as I wanted. Several dozen magical projectiles were able to hit only 8 opponents and wound 3 more. The others managed to duck behind fortifications, or else they repulsed the spears with swords, or else their personal shields protected them. But even so, after about 20 minutes, we completely cleared the area around the mansion and moved onto the walls. All this time, the enemy was hammering at it with all their guns. Clods of soil were blasted out of the wall in different directions, forming deep craters. But right away, they were overgrown. After all, we had 2 Earth Mages here with energy storage devices. They could restore the walls until the break of day. I expected the enemy would run out of ammo before then. The Viscount's people were all on one side of the wall, and I climbed onto the top of it from the other side. This was because Kuki reported that another large detachment was approaching. This was Negrieva's men, and she herself was coming here for a reason. I immediately felt her heart among the crowd of fighters, who all had a lot of military equipment.
Ludwig, please make me a chair, a beautiful chair, I asked my mage, and he immediately broke into a smile.
He was unhappy about how very ordinary the wall was. He made up for it with the chair, though.
That being said, how to call it a chair? It was nothing short of a throne. I didn't know where he got the green marble, but it looked, well, nice. Oh no, I see. The mage, wanting to make the throne more beautiful, tore out one of the columns that supported the balcony in the Viscount's mansion. But it was worth it. It was amazing. And now I sat in a chair above the tallest tower. The view from here was excellent, and when I enhanced my vision, I could see the enemy army in great detail. "Hello!" I called the Viscountess using my cell phone. I couldn't help but smile when I spotted her. I felt her heart begin to beat faster, but I didn't think it was from love. "Can I congratulate you?"
"How?"
she began to almost sputter with indignation.
"How dare you?"
Oh, she was actually speechless, and now she was shouting something incoherent into the phone. "I see you don't want my congratulations," I sighed. "But I'll tell you anyway. Your enemy is defeated. Congratulations!" I gave her time to rejoice and briefly savour the taste of victory. "But there is one but. It just so happens that you're next, and it will happen much faster than you think. So then, until soon." And then I cut the call and lounged in my chair, waiting for her reaction.
Chapter 2. The Viscountess was in her armored SUV in the column of guards, and was at a loss as to how this could happen. It was simply impossible to fathom. How could this come to be? Before, they'd all assumed that the Bulatovs were relying on some reserves of powerful ancient artifacts to keep themselves from going under. This was the only explanation for the fearlessness and bellicosity of the new head of the family. But they had to deplete their stash of artifacts sooner or later. Look, though, at how they'd taken over the Negriev family's flagship residence. With all of her money, all of her connections and powers, the Viscountess had been unable to accomplish this, despite her best efforts. Of course, it could well be that Bulatov's success could be attributed to her husband's stupidity. He'd thrown everything he had into the last battle with her, his wife. And this was the result. Bulatov caught him out in a moment of weakness. It was simple as that. But where did Bulatov get the money for mercenaries? He had to have used them, because he and his handful of guards could not possibly cope with even the remnants of the Viscount's forces. She saw at least 20 men on the walls, and who knows how many are holed up in the mansion itself. The upshot was that she had more questions than answers. But by hook or by crook, she just had to get that mansion back. Bulatov wouldn't be able to escape from there no matter how hard he tried, because her husband's remaining forces had started assembling from all of the lands under his control and had already set up 3 large camps not far from this revolting wall. In fact, that's exactly why she decided to retreat. Why not let her chump of a husband, now her enemy, do the work for her? And then she could swoop in with all that she had to roll over the remnants of her husband's forces, and finally she would be the one to occupy the mansion. It's not that the mansion itself was worth all that, but she'd been battered and bruised and needed this, not to mention she had documents and other items that were of vital importance. In fact, that was the main thing. But of course, the mansion, well, it had symbolic value as the family nest. And it wasn't just Bulatov who had hidden reserves. Maybe he had a storehouse of artifacts, and even a source of money from who knows where. But she, too, had been saving for a rainy day. She'd paid a considerable amount of money to trusted mercenaries from a nearby city. An army of 300 with supplies and arms was slated to show up soon, and they'd start planning their assault right away. The Viscountess had been thinking about her best strategy, and she decided they needed to act quickly and decisively. Her husband's forces were scattered all over, and he'd failed to secure the family nest. Well, she wasn't about to make the same mistake. So then she allocated 1,500 loyal guards to her personal protection. Another 100 would set about capturing the lands her husband left without protection. And as for the 300 mercenaries,
"Head for the mines and storm them. Capture the fortress, but do what you can to not harm the civilians. We can use them as prisoners."
She smiled. She knew now that Bulatov had his soft spot.
He cared too much about his people, even the commoners. Having issued her orders and receiving confirmation, finally Negrieva was able to relax. Now all she could do was wait. Once she'd captured Bulatov's fortress, she could call the bastard and initiate negotiations from a position of strength. The way some people live. Well, I looked at the gaudy interior of the Negriev mansion's huge drawing room and thought of my own. I had a stone floor, close to bare walls, and a fireplace tucked into a corner. Here they had a marble floor polished to a shine, pompous paintings in luxurious frames hanging on the walls, luxuriant tapestries, and gold-embroidered curtains over the huge windows. The room had all sorts of statues, vases, and art pieces. Clearly the Viscount favoured luxury. Meanwhile, all this time I lived in the midst of renovations and construction work. It was a little offensive, really. Of course, we'd messed this place up whilst occupying it, but the household staff put things back in order with lightning speed. I'd let them out of the room I'd herded them into so that they could do their thing. They carried out the corpses, wiped the blood off the floor, and quickly prepared us some food. Of course, I also let them out so that they, too, could have something to eat. After all, hunger made anyone anxious. Really, things were already stressful enough. Why make it worse for no reason? In fact, our bodies are such that we can't be nervous whilst consuming food. I'd actually heard that they give people food on long-distance flights, so that they don't fret and bother the crew. As for the Viscountess, she was smart enough not to attack us here. She realized right away it would be futile. What a shame, though, that her husband's troops couldn't be sicked on her. It might have worked, had she not retreated so swiftly. Now she was no doubt coming up with her next insidious plans. She had to have some nasty moves up her sleeve. And that is why I had a team of pigeons watching her every move and providing me the info. For now, I was stuck here. We were surrounded by three enemy camps, and the only one who could leave was Valeri in the combat suit. Our helicopters would be shot down right away, so it would be foolish to summon them here. All that remained was to wait. The Viscount had lost his top commanders, and he himself was in prison, while, according to the pigeons, his situation was deteriorating still more. In the last couple of hours, at least 20 more men had deserted him. They viewed his cause as hopeless and had switched sides. Some had simply hit the road, fled for new horizons, and there were still others in it for easy money. They'd also abandoned ship, but only after getting what they could from the misfortune of others. The new commanders would be happy to drive their men to slaughter for, say, the Viscount, or the honour of the Negriev family. But their aim would be to get inside the mansion and grab as much plunder as they could to find a nice retirement for themselves. And there certainly was enough stuff around here, yes. As for cash, all I could find was 70,000 and a few kopecks. But just the same, there was enough loot to provide for a good living here. These paintings, for example, the handmade carpets and statues and exquisite vases. And were I to tell Cherepanov about the wine cellar, well, he'd probably join the war without a second thought, consequences be damned. But best of all, right here in the mansion was an armory. In it were various types of cutting-edge weapons, as well as all kinds of swords, spears, and bows. The latter were weapons more like for warfare in the Middle Ages, and must have come from the interface world. All of this was organized on shelving along the walls and in the center of the room under glass cases. The Viscount loved to appear to be a mysterious man of depth, and I could tell this from my interactions with him. Now, looking at his home, I was convinced I was spot on about this. Look on this saber. There's an engraving indicating that it is 500 years old, I said, looking at the beautiful weapon. This wasn't something you could pick up at the flea market. In fact, a saber like this wasn't for sale anywhere, really. And, if you were to believe it, the saber belonged to Benedict Leopoldovich Negriev, a distant ancestor of the current Viscount and the founder of the family himself, and listed on the information plate, which, by the way, was made of pure gold, were all of Benedict's exploits. Really, judging by what I read, Benedict was a legendary figure.
That's an engrossing tale,
smirked Chinomor, also fascinated by the weapons.
The only problem is that the Negriev family is not even 200 years old.
This was a sneaky but common trick, though. Many of the lesser families try to extend their lineage back 200 or 300 years to make themselves appear to be older than the neighbor, say. Right now, it wasn't hard to check the record, but in a couple of generations, it might well be impossible to say that these were historical inaccuracies. And then who could say that this Benedict never existed? So if the family had the power, they could always make their false claims, or falsify any archives, and much more. However, the authentic families had genuine archives, and they couldn't be fooled. Just the same, bribery could get a person far. This sword might do the trick for the right amount. It was a high-quality ceremonial weapon, and all you needed was the right artisan to refashion the look of the coats of arms. In any event, it was good that I found this cache of ancient weapons. None of them really belonged to Negrieva. The same with the documents. I had them loaded into boxes to be sent to the castle. Once there, we'd start sorting them out and studying them. Right now, there was no time for that. They looked like certificates, seals, records, and accounts and such. All of this was good stuff. To get hold of records like this meant gaining complete control over the family. I'd also learn about all of the secrets and terms between the Negriev family and their unofficial overlord, Count Kurchatov. Time for me to start digging into what he was about to. Do you know what's interesting? I turned to Chinomor as we were looking at the paintings in one of the galleries. Before now, I thought that the Viscount had absolutely no taste. I thought that all of his artwork merited the auction block. But no, apparently I was wrong. In fact, one of the rooms had truly worthy paintings hung on the walls. I could gaze for hours at the ancient depictions of a riot of elements, the beauty of nature, the majestic severity of architecture. No doubt they were created by great masters, and it would be blasphemous to sell them. Yes, this would be what I called good taste. I nodded to myself, and Chinomor chuckled.
Mikhail, all the paintings in this room were stolen. They were taken from none other than the crow's nest of the Bulatovs. That was a winter hunting residence, and it was destroyed about 5 years ago. And I was racking my brains about who'd done the dirty deed, he said.
But of course, we needed to bring all of this back to the castle. And we'd put everything else up for sale. Aristocrats love luxury, and so I wasn't worried about finding buyers. But not in this city. As a rule, none of the locals would buy from us here. But we did have a cargo helicopter and a pilot for it. So all we had to do was put fuel in our bird and send all this stuff off to the auctions. And we'd do it in the near future. But right now we were surrounded and had plenty of problems. As I was taking a look around, my intelligence reported on the Viscountess's plans. A large detachment of mercenaries that had just arrived in the city was heading for my mines. They numbered some 300 troops, all well armed with equipment. It was a serious force to be contended with, especially considering that we had all of 20 of my guards defending the fortress right now. The rest were all at the castle, where the disabled were now receiving treatment, and also the off-worlders, who were training for battle. But we couldn't take them from the castle, because then it would be up for grabs. I called Victoria, because the fortress forces were in danger of being overwhelmed. I had a couple of surprises I'd prepared in advance for such an occasion, and I figured that now was the time to tell her about them.
How many mercenaries?
She asked again, not believing what I said. I'd briefed her already on the Viscountess's plans.
300?
Yes, give or take. What would you suggest doing? There's no way I can help.
I guess I'll have them load the cargo helicopter with corpses and go off to defend my lands from all manner of trash.
Victoria muttered through clenched teeth. Clearly she was royally pissed off by the situation. Excellent! I had to smile at that.
But we don't need to transport any of the dead. I have two freezers embedded in the wall of the fortress, and they're chock full of some choice bodies.
And why am I only now finding out about this?
She asked, astonished. I said nothing in response. I'd only recently had the freezers installed. We did this kind of thing in my old world. We'd say, bury 50 or 60 bodies in the ground here and there, just in case, and a frost artifact would maintain them in a tolerable condition for several years.
However, it's not important.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.